morning. Father Divine, we trust Holy Spirit that you will continue to minister to us. You will reach out unto us. You will take over at this time and bless each and every one of us with what you want us to hear and what you want us to know. And at the end of this talk, I'm trusting and believing you that every one of us will be better. Mothers will be better. Women. And Lord, our prophecy will appear unto all men in Jesus' name. Father, just take us through this study, O God. In Jesus' name we have prayed. So we are looking at building a godly home. And our lead text for today is going to be Proverbs 14 verse 1 and Proverbs 31 verse 10 to 31. And in Proverbs 14 verse 1, the Bible tells us there that every wise woman buildeth her home, her house, but the foolish plucketh it down with her hands. When you look at that particular passage of scripture, you know there are two different kinds of women described there, the godly and the foolish. And actually, one person can actually be a godly woman at one point and choose to be foolish at another time because of how she decided to do things. And I believe that we will not be foolish, we will be godly in Jesus' name. And that Proverbs, how can you have a women's conference and not talk about Proverbs 31, verse 10 to 31? And our sister referred to it, I'm not going to read it. And when you look at Proverbs 31, I'm sure you all know Proverbs 31, 10 to 31. My prayer is that me, every one of us, will be Proverbs 31 woman in Jesus, women in Jesus' name. There will be virtuous women. In fact, the long and short of what Proverbs 31 is telling us is that we should be women of integrity, we should be disciplined women, we should be homemakers, we should be women that train our children so well, and we that love our husbands. And I believe that as we go through this study, this talk today, the Spirit of the Lord will help us, will be home builders in Jesus' name. I don't want you to switch off if you are not married, or if you are young, or one of our young girls in this conference today, because actually you have an advantage, because you have the benefit of hearing all this before you start a home, before you get married and have children, because you can then shape your home the way God wants you to shape it. I think many of us probably didn't have that advantage. Some of us became Christians after we have got married. Some of us became Christians after we had a series of children, maybe 2-3 children. We have done it the way we like. And if not for God that helped us to know him, we probably not have been able to make our home what it is today. So you have an advantage as young girls in our midst today, as single girls and women in our midst today, to hear all these things. So be putting them in the bank so that when finally you get married, when finally you start a home, you can just put all this into practice. And I'm definitely sure you know our world is fast changing. It's a fast changing world. Everything in these contemporary times is changing so quickly before our very eyes. In recent times, the home is no longer what it should be with regard to God's standard in Christian homes. There's even no standard for homes these days. Even Christian homes, you hear what's happening in some Christian homes, it will shock you. Many homes are in shambles these days, far from godly, with husbands and wives traveling in different directions, you know, and them looking for different things in life. Her sister told us about money. Some women are so money driven, they don't even have time for their homes. They don't have time for their children. They don't have time for their husbands. And the husband is praying every day that God, why not just touch this woman? So you know that the state of your affairs now is far-reaching, is a far-reaching consequence for the church and the world at large. The result of it is wayward children, disgruntled children, disgruntled husbands, and things seem not to be godly at all. The question then is, how then do we build a godly home in a morally decaying world, in a world that is completely disorganized, in a world that is completely in shambles? We'll consider this talk under a few headings. The first one is the challenges. We look at the challenges of the 21st century, the characteristics of our present day world, so that will help us to start thinking of how then would I, in this scenario that I find myself, how then could I build a godly home? Then after looking at the challenges of the 21st century and the challenges of our time, if you prefer that word, we then look at what then does a godly home look like. And after that, after we then look at what a godly home look like, we then look at tips for building a godly home, because we look at the challenges of our time, we then look at what a godly home would look like, and then we look at tips for building a godly home. And lastly, blessings of a godly home. And I believe as we go ahead, the Lord will teach us and minister to each and every one of us in Jesus' name. So let's look at the characteristics of our present day time. The characteristics of our present day time. No, there are quite a lot of characteristics of our present day time. The first one is the way we live, the way we dress, our eating habits, our general outlook to life. You know, now there are, in this present day and age, duties at home are being shared between husbands and wife. In fact, now presently, there's a line of division. Even the bedside that men, in fact, I was surprised when I heard this, when a colleague was telling me at work that her side of the bed, so she has the side of the bed and her husband has the side of bed as well. So they have their own, and they're married, and house chores. She told me he has his own duty at home. He hovers the house, and he washes the cars. And apart from that, there are one or two things, and he cook. I think Sunday is his own cooking day. So there are different things that are happening in our present day world. You know why? So these are things that we need to start thinking about when we start looking at a godly, before we look at what then does a godly home look like. And another point I would like us to look at is there is the feminist movement now, fighting hard for the right of women, that whatever a man can do, a woman can actually do better. So yeah, a woman can do much, much better than what a man can do. And also career women, many women now live for their own career. They sacrifice their home for life at work. There are those who work 9 a.m. to 9 p.m. And they don't even have time for their home. They are not homemakers, you know, because of this rising need, you know, to support the husband's income. Our sister told us about money making. Some people are so driven with money, they don't even think. They're ready to work. They're ready to even leave their children at home and lock the door. You know, I hear all kinds of things. Some people leave their children, little tiny babies in the house, children in the house that are not even up to ages that they should be left at home. And they've gone to work, and that's the story of their life, to make money. Tragically, in today's society, poor value is placed on family life. A general lack of respect for family values. There's no respect for family values again. So then you start wondering, what does the godly home then look like in this whole scenario where we find, in this world and age that we find ourselves? And you see, there's no more family value, that everybody's pulling in different directions. The mobile phone world. The moment that we are home, we are looking at the mobile phone. We are checking what's there. We are looking at WhatsApp, Facebook, Twitter, you know, Instagram. There's no time to even talk with husband. We don't even chat. You know, those days you sit around the table, you eat, there's nothing like that anymore. You sit down with your husband, you have a chat. What happened today? What didn't happen yesterday? There's no time, because the little time we have, we are checking the Facebook, we are checking our Twitter, yeah, Instagram, we are looking at our WhatsApp. In fact, we are married to our mobile phone. I believe God will help us as we begin to look at this study in Jesus' name. Not well-managed relationship is another challenge of our time, and lack of time together, like I've said. And what normally happens is the home is broken down, divorce rate is high, because people don't even have time to talk to challenge each other. Too much of focus on materialism, keeping pace with the Joneses, wanting to just make sure I'm also there, you know, I'm also in the noticed world. I pray God. What of the LGBTQ agenda, including the non-binary agenda? Activities of gender fluidity. We have to talk about that, you know, because it's something that's so rampant in our time now. And we shouldn't shy away from it in the Church of God. We need to begin to really open our eyes to all these things, you know. Recent decisions of the Methodist Church, you heard it yourself, that Methodist Church now said they are going to be marrying gay lesbian people. And that's, in all this scenario, we want to build a godly home. What of abortion? Do it yourself. Abortion kits now is available to children. They shouldn't even tell you as their parents that they're pregnant. They will just buy the kit and they'll abort themselves at home. You know, it's something that all these things are happening. You have kids in your house, you don't even know what they have dived into. You don't even know what they are doing. That's the world we are in right now. What of teenage issues leading to waywardness and worldliness? There's a magazine now, they call it Teen Vogue. I'm sure you know, maybe you don't know. I think we women, we need to begin to, don't just see I'm spiritual, not delve into what's going on in our world. There's Teen Vogue magazine. That magazine is there to educate our children, the younger generation. 99.9% of young children, teenagers in this world, they read that magazine. And all that is there is rubbish. It's nonsense. And I believe that. And in all this scenario, we want to build a godly home. When our children go to school, they meet with those kids. Even if you don't endorse them reading those magazines at home. You don't even know what they are reading on their mobile phone, because you're not 24 hours with them looking at what they are looking at on the mobile phone. You don't know whether they also go into those, read those articles, so that they will fit in school and be able to chat around it when they get to school with their peers, because their peers are not deeper life peers. Their peers don't go to church, or they don't even know the Lord. So all this is what we are dealing with as women, as mothers, and that we are still going to deal with when we finally get married, if you are not married. And many times the church is undermined. The church is not, the society does not think about church at all. They are not interested. And you see, you yourself know, when during the lockdown wanted to be eased. It was when they had the pub, if you watch the news that time, when they told us when the pub was going to be opened some few months ago, the whole nation was happy. If you see the jubilation, if you see the happiness, but no mention of church. In fact, when they mentioned church, there is no church. In fact, everything was quiet and cold. In fact, the church was mentioned as part of leisure. They didn't see the church as significant. It was a part of the leisure centers. So I pray God will help us. So in this whole scenario, they have painted the challenges of the 21st century. So now, what does a godly home look like? A godly home, let's look at it, is a home that is built on the word of God, his will, his precepts, and his expectation. A home where the fear of God is real and visible. A home where, despite all the situation I've painted, God, Christ is still their counselor. Christ is still the head of that home. Despite all the scenario I've painted, a home where the wife knows her role and responsibility and happy in it. And now that women have a right, women can do, women have, in fact, it looks like women are even more powerful in this. Yeah, I remember in my own church, there was a particular sister that told her husband and said, do you know that women are so powerful in this England? And her husband just came from Africa. And her husband said, so women are so powerful in this England. And she said, okay, do you want me to try something? And the man said, yes, try it. And he said, you touch me. And the man just touched her. And he said, I'll call the police now, say you touch me. You see, they'll come and carry you. And truly, she just rang the police, and the police came and took her away from the, and said they are taking him away. And she started crying that they should give her husband back, foolish woman. Do you know, she was crying, please give me my husband back, we're only playing. And the police said, no, he was in custody for about 2-3 days before they released him. So these are the challenges we are dealing with. So, and we need to begin to think of how to build a home. A home where the wife knows her role and responsibility, and we're happy in it. A home where there's mutual respect and submission between husband and wife. My husband was reading a book one time. The book was titled Submission is for Husband Too. And I said to him, what kind of title is this? He said, it's true. He said, what you women don't know, when we talk about submission, you always switch off, you're always angry. That's it always us. He said, for this book is telling husbands that actually the submission God expects of you husbands is deeper than what God expects of women. That God is telling us to love our wife. That if you're going to truly love your wife, submission is also for husbands too. So a home reflecting the love, gentleness, and meekness of Jesus Christ in everything we do. Despite the world we are living in, we have to build a godly home. A home where God is the hub of family life and endeavors, instead of just a mere mention of the name of God in religiosity. Like we see it in many homes these days, they just say they are Christians, they say they are Catholic, they say they are Anglican, some of them say they are Pentecostal, but it's just religion. They don't really know God. Their home is not built on the solid foundation of the word of God. A home where children are taught the way of the Lord, a home where the presence of God is evident, and neighbors can see it. That's the godly home. That's the home we are talking about this afternoon. And I believe that as we continue to look at this, the Spirit of the Lord will minister to us in Jesus' name. Now, the tips for building this kind of home in this very, very horrible time that we are living. What are the tips for building a godly home? The Bible says in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, 2, and 5, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. The first tip for building a worldly home, my sister, is wisdom of salvation. You can't do it if you are not saved. You can't do it if you are not born again. If you are unsaved, if you are not born again, how do you want to manifest the fruit of the Spirit? You'll be destitute of the fruit of the Spirit. You can't. So my challenge for you today, if you don't know God, or you are playing church, or you are not a Christian, or you don't really understand, or you are just wishy-washy, your leg is in today, it's out tomorrow, get saved. Get truly born again. Because it's when you are born again, you can pray. You can pray for your children. You can pray for your husband. You can manifest the fruit of the Spirit. You can look at the scenario that has been painted in the world, the LGBT agenda, and really hold the ground and ask the Lord for direction and say, Lord, in this kind of scenario, when there's man marriage, when our children go to school, but their friends could be coming out from a home that they go to a gay affirming church, they're coming from a gay lesbian affirming family. They are in a man. They are coming from a home that their parents are man, or their husband, their friends could, or coming from their parents that can be man, or woman. You know, that's the thing. And you want the godly wisdom to be able to counsel your children, and to talk them away from all these evil influences all around. I told you about Teen Vogue before. To explore what happened in school today. Did you hear? What did your friend say today? Who is your friend actually? So that friend is her mom and dad like me and your dad, or is your mom and dad man or woman? Don't talk as if you are judging or ever, because if you are like that, kids they will not listen. They say my mom all this deeper life thing. She doesn't even understand, not knowing that it's them that don't understand. So you need to be able to cleverly, by the wisdom of God, know how to bring up these children, talk to them, shaping your home in a godly way. So yeah, the wisdom of salvation is so key in building a godly home. Bible says in verse 2 of Romans chapter 5 that by whom also we have access by faith into the grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. It's somebody that the love of God is shed abroad in their hearts that can build a godly hope. Galatians chapter 5 verse 22 that I said, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, is joy, is peace, is long-suffering, is gentleness, is goodness, is faith, is meekness, is temperance, and against such there is no law. If you're not born again, you can't manifest the fruit of the Spirit. If you're not born again, you can't lead a godly home. If you're not born again, you can't have long-suffering. You can't be gentle. You can't be good. You can't have meekness. You can't have faith. You can't have temperance. You'll be angry and upset every second, every minute. Everything will upset you because you are not happy. But if you're born again, you cleverly look at things, you take a step back and say, Lord, is a godly home I want, and this is not plain before me, help me, oh God. And I believe God will help you and I in Jesus' name. The second aspect of another tip that I have is wisdom of knowing your purpose in your family. The wisdom of knowing your purpose in your home. God called us helpmate. Wisdom to know that we are helpmate and we're happy with that. To stay in our role and be happy in our role. It was one of our mothers in the Lord that was preaching, our former GS wife that was preaching, and said, the wisdom to be happy in your role. The wisdom to stay in your role and just love it. Bible says in Genesis chapter 2 verse 18 that and God said, it is not good that a man should be alone. I will make him and help meet for him. The wisdom to know that we are helpmate and be happy as helpmate. God has called us to support our husbands, to help in the homemaking. God has not called us to take over from them. Some of us, especially in this day and age, some of us have had flying jobs. Some of us, our husbands are not even earning as much as us, but that does not mean we take over the control. That is not what the Bible is telling. We will never be happy. That can never be a godly home. The husband can never be happy. That home can never be a happy home when you are taking the whole of control from him. You are the helpmate. Gladly relinquishing control. And also in Proverbs 31 verse 11 and 12, our sister read Proverbs to us before. Bible says the heart of her husband does safely trust in her, so that he shall have no need of spoil. She will do him good, not evil, all the days of her life. Every woman, and if that's Proverbs 14 verse 1 that we read before, says every woman buildeth her house, but the foolish one plucketh it down with her hands. Sisters, you must know your purpose as indeed a helpmate for your husband. As a woman of the Spirit, we are to make it our business to please our husbands. Just love it. That's what the Bible says. That's what God told you and I. And let's be happy with that. We must voluntarily relinquish control, like I said, for husband. We must comport ourselves in a way that husband reposes their entire confidence in us. We must be completely devoted to them. You know, completely, we don't see devotion these days. There's all kinds of immorality these days. There's all kinds of evil these days. You go to work, you hear all kinds of things. In fact, many times I say to myself, things I've heard with my ears. Once I had a colleague was sharing and say we're talking about a relationship, and I heard that she's having in your place of work, you don't even know who is having affair with who. You don't know. You just see them because you are Christians. Probably you are Christian. They wouldn't let you know, but it's all happening. In fact, many times I wonder the children they are dragging all over the place. Who knows whether it's actually the person that their husband that owns that children. We are living in a world that there's no chastity anymore. Look, you saw it in the whole of in the heat of pandemic. Our own health secretary, Matt Hancock, with his own wife, with his own children, is having an affair with another woman, with his own husband, with her own children. And the moment the story broke out some few weeks ago, they both left their partners and moved together. Shameless people. And that's the story. That's the example. That's what is happening in our world. That's it. That's it. It was a particular sister that was telling me that was working in Nosley Housing Trust one time and said that, do you know what happened? You don't even know what's going on. This particular staff, this particular woman went to a house to help check the house before another tenant moving. Is a housing association. And the workers came, the men that came in with her to check the house to see whether there are repairs that needed to be done before the new tenant moved into the house the next 2 weeks. Both of them slept with her. And she came back to work and she was saying it and said, you know what, I just finished having a nice time. Both of them actually slept. And she's married, you know. So that's the word. You know, many times you hear these things, they look unreal, but it's actually the stupidity of our own time. So, but we building a godly home. Our husband repose their confidence in us. We don't give them any reason to doubt us at all. We are completely, completely devoted to our husband. And we make sure our children knows that. So that when they also start a home, they are completely devoted as well. I know there are unspoken words that go on in our homes. Our children watches us. They look at what we are doing. They look at the kind of things that is happening here and there. You know, even though they didn't see anything, they picked everything up. And when they start their home, they will emulate us. They will do exactly what we are doing. What of wisdom of love and submission? Love and submission. Many of us, many women feel, oh God, when they talk about godly, all they are going to tell me today is submit to your husband. As if there's nothing else in the Bible. My sister, do you know what? Love and submission is deeper than what we are talking about. Romans chapter 5, verse 5 says that, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given unto us. Ephesians 5, verse 22 says, wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as is unto the Lord. A woman that is after God's godly home will show her love to her husband, not by foolish fondness, that's what we are talking about, but by prudent endearment, that you love them. That's it. She submits to her husband. What we mean here is you value the leadership of your husband and allow him to influence you and serve you in a positive way. You know, we look at submission so different. It's just we value them. We show them we value them. Sometimes after my husband has finished preaching or doing something, I know he's tired, especially when we've had a long conference, you know, and usually I'll make up my mind that I'm going to do his lovely dish, the dish he loves so much. I would have prepared it. So after the long haul conference, I'll do it. And when it comes home, when it probably be counseling, I'll quickly get home so that when the dish is cooking, you'll be as soon as you open the door, you will feel the aroma. You can smell it. And as soon as you come straight to the kitchen, usually and say, oh God, did you cook this meal? And I'll say yes, because I know you'll be tired. And I know you just need to rest now. You've done really well. You've done extremely well. In fact, I actually quite enjoy all the sermons you preach in this conference. It's so wonderful. I enjoyed them. You know, it's just valuing their leadership and allow them to just show that you respect and you love them, you know? So I pray God will help us. We value their leadership, allow them to influence us and serve us positively as well. You know, when you do that to a husband, it will love you. It will not want to offend you. It will just not want to do anything nasty to you. You know, you show your love and submission to him through your support and believe in him. You show that you believe in him. Sometimes you go shopping. It's not deliberately sometimes. When I see something that is nice and we go out shopping together, I see something that say, and he will say, oh, that one is a bit better. Maybe we should go. Deliberately sometimes I go for what he said. And finally, And we get home and we start looking at the colors or whatever. I can remember when we were building our kitchen, we said, oh, mommy, do you know what? Maybe we should have gone for that one that you said. I said, okay. And we've chosen this one too. Next time we choose my own. So we deliberately, you know, relinquish control and submission to them. You also show your love and submission by offering him forgiveness and grace when sometimes he demonstrates poor leadership. I think that's the challenge with some of us women. We don't leave them to fail. Leave them to make that mistake and let them come back. And you show them forgiveness and love, even in that mistake, you still love them because they're not small, they're still our husbands anyway. So yeah, that's the you offer forgiveness and grace when sometimes they demonstrate poor judgment and poor leadership. You don't take over. Remember, you have voluntarily relinquished control to him. So yeah, that's how to love and to submit her husband. A wife should not be a burden or a hindrance to her husband. This is contrary to God's plan. The presence and influence of a godly woman in the life of a man should be like an asset, not a liability. And I believe God will help us that will be an asset. We'll not be a liability to our husbands. Husband will not be afraid of us. You know, some husbands, they are so scared of their wives that will not be the story of our own lives in Jesus' name. What of wisdom of work and industry? That's a very, very powerful one. Wisdom of work and industry. We read that in that Proverbs 31, you know, the virtuous woman story. Wisdom of love that we are hardworking. The Bible says there in Proverbs 31, I'll just look at verse 13 to 19. The Bible says she seeketh wool and flax and worketh willingly with her hands. She's like a merchant ship. She bringeth her food from afar. She riseth also while it is yet night and giveth meat to her household and a portion to her maidens. She considereth a field and buy it with the fruit of her hands. She planted a vineyard. You can see work there. You can see hard work in what I read there. She gathered her loins in verse 17 with strength. She strengthened her arms. She's not lazy. She's hardworking. She didn't say, because I marry a Christian husband, a consecrated brother, I can't talk. So I can sleep till Jesus comes. I'll just be sleeping. I'll just do what I like. I'll cook rice. When I'm tired, I'll just keep cooking rice. I'll do butter and bread for the children. No. She's a woman of industry, a woman of hard work. Verse 18, she perceived that merchandise is good. Her candle goeth not out by night. You heard what her sister told us this morning. She's somebody that she's very forthright. She sees from afar off, you know, she can see very far. And she knows that, oh, no, this is good. I'll buy this one. This is not good. I'm not going to buy this. Actually, this is going to be a drain on the family. If I invest in this, this is not good enough. She knows what to invest in. She knows what not to invest in. She knows what would be a drain in the purse of the home. And I believe God will help you and I to be so forthright in Jesus' name. You know, she laid her hand to the spindle and her hands hold the distaff. That's what we read about the virtuous woman. And in fact, the story of the virtuous woman is so instructive. It's actually King Lemuel's mother that painted that picture of a busy woman for her son, which is the king, because she was saying to her son that you're going to get married, but who I want you to marry is a woman of discipline, a woman of industry, a virtuous woman, a woman that will respect you, a woman that will be obedient to you, a woman that will bring the children properly up, a woman that will have servants and the servants will call her Lord, a woman that will not look at the fact that she's married to a king and take the back seat, but a woman that will be there, that will know the state of her fears in the home. That's his mom challenging him that who can find a virtuous woman. That look, Lemuel, my son, if you are getting married, this is the woman you should marry. Isn't that a godly counsel from a godly woman? A woman who felt burdened to complete task that she set herself each day and each day of the week. That's exactly the picture King Lemuel's mother is painting. King Lemuel's mother is painting. A woman that hates to sit still and do nothing. A woman that keeps herself busy, works hard, and very industrious as one that recognizes the dignity of labor, She's not going to rely on them. Socials, you know, and social security, and just believing us. No. She's not a woman that's lazy. She's a woman that wants to work and contribute something in the family. She's a woman that does not admit or tolerate idleness. A woman that stretches out her hands to the distaff so as to know how to use the tool. That's what the picture that we had of the virtue. She doesn't need to know how to use those tools or they were using in those days. The Bible told us that she guards her loins and she looks at how the the servants are using the tool in the family, and she learns it as well. She told them to teach her how to use those tools. That's a virtuous woman. She knows how to, the technology that is there does this. She learns it and she uses it. Even though the virtuous woman is a woman of high ranking and wealth, she learned how to use them, like I said, and did not see any job as menial below her dignity to do in the house. She would do it. That's the picture King Glamour's mother was painting of a wife for King Glamour. That this, if you're getting married, this is, if you want a godly home, if you want to build a godly home, that's the woman that is fitting. And I believe God will help you and I to look at areas we have got it wrong. Yeah, we can still make amends. Some people didn't have the opportunity to make amends. Some people are unbelievers. Their home is in shambles. Look at all the marriages that we celebrate in the world now. You go to marriages of the people of the world at work. After 2 years, they are divorced. In fact, 2 years is quite a lot. After a year or 6 months, they have gone separate ways because it's not a godly home. They didn't hear what we are hearing. And I believe that as we are hearing all these things, the Spirit of the Lord will motivate us to do what is right. And if we've done something wrong, if our home is not where it should be, and God will help us. You just need to pray and God will help us to go back to the drawing board. Yeah, I believe, yeah, God will help us to go back to the drawing board in Jesus' name. Yeah, she did all that, everything she did, not because she's idle. She did everything because she just wants to be involved in the family. She's not an I buy woman like her sister told us. I'll tell you the story of somebody that was given an honorary degree. As part of, in the university, they give honorary degree to people that they felt have done really well in the community, but they just want to recognize them, honorary professorship. Every university does that every graduation year. You have people you want to give honorary prof, you have people that you want to give honorary doctorate degree. So this man, they gave him honorary degree, and as part of the honorary degree, they have to give a speech. And they told this man to give a speech on complete and finished. Listen to what the man said. He said, if you marry a good wife, you are complete. If you marry a bad wife, you are finished. If you marry a wife that loves shopping, you are completely finished. That's his own. So yeah, so we need to be careful. We need to know how to build a godly home. We need to look inward as women and look at ourselves and say, what's going to be my brand? How am I going to build a godly home? What am I going to do differently from today? How am I going to sit back and make this home what it ought to be? 1 Timothy chapter 5 verse 13 says, and withal they learn to be idle, wandering about from house to house, and not only idle, but tactless also, and busybody, speaking things they ought not to. We're not busybodies in other people's matter. We're not idle. We don't go from house to house as women. We are not. We have enough in our homes. We have enough in our plate. You know, we need to get the balance right. You don't even have the time. By the time you come back to work, you want to invest in your children. By the time your husband comes, you want to sit down, have a chat, and talk about the home, and even talk about something else. You know, you don't want to be glued to the mobile phone and be gossiping on the mobile phone. That's not the life God called us to if you want to build a godly home. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 10 to 11 says, for even when we were with you, this we command you, that if any would not walk, neither should he eat. We hear that there are some which walk among you disorderly, walking not as all, but are busybodies. We don't want to be busybodies. A godly woman that wants to build a godly home can never be busybodies. Proverbs 21 verse 25 says, desire of the slothful killeth him. I can rightly say here, killeth her, for his hands refuse to labor. We are not going to be slothful. We are not going to be people that our hands refuse to labor. Proverbs 20 verse 13 says, love not sleep, lest thou come to poverty. Open thine eyes and thou shalt be satisfied with bread. We can't love sleep. As we don't take advantage of the fact that our husbands are Christians, let's not be lazy. Let's walk with our hands. Let's look at the wisdom of training. The wisdom, the fifth one is the wisdom of training. And Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, 6, 7 said something there. It said, and thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy might. And these words which I command thee this day shall be in thy heart. And thou shalt teach them diligently unto thy children and shalt talk of them when thou sittest in thy house and when thou walkest by the way. And when thou liest down, wisdom of training. A woman that wants to build a godly home has the prerogative to train her children. These days, mothers are too preoccupied with their work, and there's little or no time for child training. We don't even know what's going on with those children. We are so preoccupied in the way we don't do much with our children. And I believe this today we are going to change. Oftentimes, most women are out very early in the morning and would not return until very late. We do not realize that a vacuum is being created in our own availability to spend time with our children. In these days where we have been, you know, like I said before, of gender fluidity, we've talked about the Teen Vogue magazine. Check it out. You go there after today, maybe when you get home, Google Teen Vogue and see what they have there for young people. All the young people in this world read it. Even we, our Christian children, some of them, you don't know what they read on their mobile phone because they want to fit in schools as well. So you need to be able to have a way of talking to those children. I'll tell you something. There is one of the articles that I picked up in Teen Vogue and just about some few weeks ago. And they said, and the experts talking to our children, our teens said that, listen to what the experts said, sex should be embraced in whatever way it feels right or seems right to you. You can do it as long as it's consensual. If sex makes you happy, do it. Do whatever makes you happy. If you love him or her, sleep with them. Don't hold back. I'm not telling, you know what? You go there. In fact, what I'm reading to you is even mild. Some of the things there, you will weep. And you'll be wondering, many of we Christian mothers, we don't even explore. We don't even switch into the world to see what's going. A woman that wants to build a godly world, you don't just sit at home and be reading Bible and going to church and say, I'm a Christian. No, dive into what's out there in the world, because our children are in the world. They are mixing with them so that you know what kind of advice, how you are going to nicely shape the thoughts and the thinking of your own children. That one says, don't overthink it. Just follow your heart. That's sleeping with men now. You don't overthink it. Just follow your heart. This is the advice the world is giving to younger people in our world today, sisters. These people advising our young people call themselves experts. What about mental illness? This is what the world also is celebrating. They celebrate depression. They celebrate anxiety because all the celebrities have mental illness. All of them said they are depressed. All of them, what's it called now? Prince Harry said he's depressed. Prince Williams is depressed. And all the celebrities, all those celebrities in Hollywood, they all have depression. So children, all the youths in our present day, they think it's actually fashionable to have mental illness. So you need to know how to, a godly woman will dive into all this. You know what the world is saying, so that when your children come back to school, you know how to shape their minds and their thoughts in conversation, not just see them that say, no, don't do this, don't do that. No, it doesn't work like that. It's gentle conversation that you throw some things in. That's what I do to my children. We could be talking in the kitchen. We could be doing some. It's gentle little conversation that you know how to slot things in. That's why salvation is important, because when you are saved, you have the wisdom of God. You have the outlook of God. You know when to, you know things that you say at different times. And I believe God will help us in Jesus' name. They tell our children, I just wonder, where is our world going? And we want to build a godly home in this scenario. I just trust that God will help you and I to be able to click with all this and build a godly home. What of wisdom of time management? What of wisdom of time management? We have talked so much about time management. You know, you just need to manage your time. You have no choice, sisters. You have absolutely no choice. You know, Bible says in Proverbs 13:1, verse 15 and 27, she riseth also while it is yet night and giveth meat to her household and a portion to her maidens. She looketh well to the ways of her household and eateth not the bread of idleness. You can't, if you want to manage your time effectively, you can't, because you want to balance work and home. You want to be able to do well at work. You want to be able to do well at home. You want to be able to train your children. You want to be able to have time for your husband. You want to be able to pray. You want to be able to go to church. You want to cater for the various aspects of life, the spiritual life, the family life, the work life. So you don't have time to be messing around. You don't have time to be idle. So you need to sit down, get your priorities right, and things that are not a priority, you leave them. You know me, I'm a woman. I don't join any. There are some prayer meetings or Bible study, you know, especially now that everything is online. There's so many things online. I sit down as a godly mother and as a godly woman. What would add value to my life? I don't just join anything. I think about what is the priority, and I'm not regretting. What I decided to leave, I leave it because I feel it would not add value to me. You know, so you need to sit down, and get your priorities life right. Psalm 90 verse 12 says, so teach us to number our days that we may apply our hearts to wisdom. You know, John chapter 9 verse 4 says, I must walk the walk of him that sent me. While it is day, the night cometh when no man can walk. Colossians chapter 4 verse 5, walk in wisdom towards them that are without, redeeming the time. In your way of redeeming the time, you know, you would sit down and decide. For many women, anything happen, anybody, they please everybody. No, you're not, I'm not like that. I don't just please anybody. I look at what would benefit me, what would benefit my family, what would benefit, what would add value to my to my life, because I have a goal. Many of us don't have a goal. Everything happens. We don't have a goal. What's your goal? What's your goal for the family? Set a goal. I call it your brand. What's your brand? You know, what's your brand? And you come up with a brand, and that will shape in your outlook to life. That will shape in what you plan to do at different points in time. What's your goal? Set a goal for your life, for your family. And that goal will encompass your family, your life, everything. And if anybody wants to crash into that goal, crash into your life, you remember your goal. You know, I believe God will help you and I. For many women who cannot manage both home front and job without one affecting the other, their inability has deprived them of a happy home. However, according to the scripture, no matter how busy we are, God intends women to still carry out their roles and responsibilities of being caring mothers, loving wives, and committed Christians. We need the wisdom of an effective time management to see home affairs and church engagement and other involvement. You know, the issue we have here is priority. We don't know how to get the priorities right. You need to get the handle of what matters most to you. When you do this, you gain a sense of focus and purpose. So if somebody brings something, they invite me to one Bible study somewhere, I'll look at my purpose, I'll think of my focus, and I'll be able to say yes or no, depending on my purpose and my focus. So what of the wisdom of a wholesome tongue? Wisdom of a wholesome tongue, that's another tip. Wisdom to speak, wisdom in speaking is so important in a healthy relationship. It's so important. You don't just speak to your husband anywhere. You know, this day and age, the way you are brought up in Africa, wherever you are from, is different from the way we bring our children up. In fact, we respect our children these days. We have to respect them. We have to talk to them in a wise way. You know, being a quarrelsome woman does not help in building a happy home. Women need to learn to control their tongue. Even when you are being provoked, you control your tongue. We can ask the Lord to help us to tame our unruly, poison-laden, untamed and contentious tongue, so that God will make us to have a kind and edifying words, words of peace, words of harmony to our children, to our husband, to our spouses. And, you know, we will be the healthier for it. Proverbs 15 verse 1 and 2 says, a soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger. Verse 2 says, the tongue of the wise useth knowledge aright, but the mouth of the fools poureth out foolishness. Proverbs 31 verse 26 says, she openeth her mouth with wisdom, and her tongue is the law of kindness. You remember? James chapter 1 verse 26 says, if any man among you seemeth to be religious, and bridleth not his tongue, but deceiveth his own heart, that man's religion is in vain. You must know how to bridle your tongue. If you say you are a Christian and you just talk anyhow, say, that's me, that's why God created me. No, you can't be anywhere. You use your hand to pull your house down. Bible says, you remember that Proverbs 14 verse 1, a wise woman builds her home and the foolish one destroys it with her own hand. You are just going to be like a little girl that plays with a Lego. You know, those little children, they play with Lego and they build a lovely house with the Lego, with that Lego. And after some time, they pull that down and build something else. Don't use your hand to pull your home down. I believe God will help us. James chapter 5, chapter 3, verse 5 says that even so, the tongue is a little member and boasted great things. Behold, how great a matter a little fire kindled. Verse 6 of that, James 3 says, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body and set it on fire, the cause of nature, and it set on the fire of hell. For every kind of things, you know, the Bible passage in verse 7 says, every kind of beast can be tamed, you know, animals, birds, serpents, they can be tamed, but the tongue, you know, can no man tame. Is, you know, the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. When you know, the Bible says that you are going to control that tongue. You're going to know what you say to your husband at different times, even when he's done some crazy, nasty thing. You just have to keep quiet and know what to say. You just have to take a step back and know that the devil wants to come into this house now. If you give the devil a chance, he will come into your home. He doesn't care. He's waiting to come in anyway. Devil is waiting. Bible told us in 1 Peter that the devil is around like a roaring lion, seeking speaking him, he will devour. And you will be so careful not to misuse your tongue, not to let the time of anger, so the child did something nasty, or the husband said something, or behave in a particular way, and just decide to release one volley, you will destroy everything. And I believe God will help you and I, in Jesus' name. Now we are going to look at the blessing that we achieve from having a godly home, the blessing of a godly home. You know, times have changed, but God remains the same. He's the unchanging and unchangeable God. He's holy and will forever remain holy. The world has gone bad and worse, like you and I know, but he that called you and I to build a godly home so that we can be salt of the earth, we can be light of the world, has not changed. His demand is still the same. There's no other way to glorify God. When we build a godly home, we have peace of mind. Our children will have good examples to emulate. We must remember that our children are watching the way we relate with our husbands. We are the examples they are seeing concerning life, concerning marriage. You know, if a marriage is full of love, respect, harmony, peace, and stability, then that's the example the children will see. But if the example they see is cheating, fighting, indiscipline, disrespect, these bad examples we shape in our children. If they see that, if what we do is gang up with our children to talk about her husband, isn't this your daddy started again? You know, it's your dad. Mom, what happened? What did he do? Mom, you can't just be taking all that. You can't just be taking all that from dad. What kind of dad? In fact, you must be in the wrong place at the wrong time when you marry daddy. You know, you don't give children the opportunity to say all that. You know, I believe God will help us, the blessing of a godly home. But if we are committed to setting the right examples, if we build our home to the pattern of divine specification, our home will be blessed and our days on earth will be like the days in heaven. 2 Samuel chapter 6, verse 11, the Bible says, and the ark of God continued in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months, and the Lord blessed the house of Obed-Edom. The Lord will bless our home if we build a home. It's not easy, my sisters, especially in this day and age, it's not, but God will give you the grace, will give you the wherewithal in Jesus' name. Jeremiah 35, verse 6 to 10, the Bible says, in the story of the Rechabites, but they said, we will drink no wine, for Jonadab, the son of Rechab, our father, commanded us, saying, you shall drink no wine, neither ye nor your sons forever. That their father that told them not to drink wine, their great-great-grandfather, that man has died and gone. But these people, the Rechabites, they still kept to the teaching of their dad. So if we build a godly home, our children will follow. They will do everything the way we want. In fact, when we are gone, because if Jesus tarries, they will follow our example. They will remember what we have been telling them. And I believe God will help you and I to build a godly home by example, by precepts, by hard work, because it's not going to be easy. A good home is not built just like that. You must invest in it. Thus, Bible says in Acts chapter 21, verse 9, the Bible talked there about Philip the evangelist, that the same man had 4 daughters, virgins, and they all prophesied. Philip brought his own children up well in the way of the Lord, and he received the profit of it, because the Bible record about the 4 daughters. If those girls are sleeping all over the place, all over the town, the Bible will not record that for us to read, you know, but because they are good children, Philip had that commendation recorded by it. That's the blessing of building a happy home. What of 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, where the Bible said, when I call to remembrance, when Paul said in Timothy, when I call to remembrance the unfeigned faith that is in thee, which dwelleth first in thy grandmother Lois and thy mother Eunice, then persuaded that is in thee also. In the life of Timothy, we all read about Timothy, Lois, and Eunice, they got the commendation for it. So there's blessing in building a happy home. When we do well, we not go unrewarded. When we do well, we'll reap the reward. Even in our grave, you know, if Jesus tarries, our children will be blessed. We call us blessed. Our husbands or whoever, if Jesus tarries, we not go unrewarded. But you know, hear what the Bible says about the virtuous woman in Proverbs 31, verse 28 to 30. The Bible says, her children ariseth and call her blessed. Her husband also, he praiseth her. Many daughters have done virtuously, but thou excelleth them all. Favor is deceitful, Beauty is vain, but a woman that feareth the Lord, she shall be praised. Give her of the fruit of her hands, and let her own works praise her in the gates. If we do well, if we build a godly home, God will reward us. Bible says there's no level of righteousness we offer the Lord that will not be rewarded. God is not righteous, that's not to reward our labor of love, in that we minister to the saints and do minister. And I believe God will help you and I to build a very godly home. In Jesus' name, we'll be sober, we'll be vigilant, we'll do the will of God. So now, the challenge I have for you is go and build. Does that make sense, sisters? It's for you to go and build. Let's have a word of prayer. Let's call upon the Lord. Let's pray. Let's ask the Lord to help us to be sober, to be vigilant.